So hi, everyone. As I was saying earlier, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you're tuning in from around the world today. Welcome to today's CNCF webinar. I'd like to thank everyone who's joining us. Today's title is MicroK8s HA Under the Hood, Kubernetes with Dqlite with Canonical. I'm Christy Tan, and I'll be moderating today's webinar. We would like to welcome our presenter, Konstantinos Tlakulos, Senior Software Engineer at Canonical. A few housekeeping items before we get started. During the webinar, you are not able to talk as an attendee. There is a Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. Please feel free to drop your questions in there and we'll get to as many as we can at the end. This is an official webinar of the CNCF and as such is subject to the CNCF Code of Conduct. Please do not add anything to the chat or questions that would be in violation of that Code of Conduct. Basically, please be respectful of all your fellow participants and presenters. Please also note that the recording and slides will be posted later today to the CNCF webinars page at cncf.io/webinars. With that, I'll hand it over to Konstantinos to kick off today's presentation. Take it away.
Thank you, Christy. Hi, everyone. I'm Konstantinos Tsakalosos. I work for Canonical on MicroK8s, and here I will be showing you how HA works in MicroK8s. First, let's see what MicroK8s is. MicroK8s is an opinionated Kubernetes distribution. It is opinionated, as you will see, in the sense that we try to minimize operational friction in both single and multi-node clusters. Of course, we are always CNCF conformant, meaning that we do not drop any features. Everything that is supported upstream is also available in MicroK8s. We target IoT devices and edge, and I would add here that we're also comfortable on developers' workstations and on CI/CD pipelines. The two hardware architectures that we support right now is x86 and ARM64. MicroK8s is built on solid foundations. It is packaged as a snap, and that means that when you deploy MicroK8s on your machine, you get with the Kubernetes binaries all of their dependencies as well as everything that is needed to set up a cluster. At runtime, MicroK8s remains isolated, very similar to what happens with OCI containers that you already know. The benefit of this setup is that since we ship the whole software stack where Kubernetes runs on, we have full control over updates. And these updates are delivered automatically whenever the administrator decides to have them installed on his cluster. This is particularly important, and I mention it here because, as you know, Kubernetes is a project that is constantly evolving and at a very fast pace. Every few weeks, we get a new patch, and that patch needs to be delivered, needs to be installed on your cluster if you want to keep it up to date. The focus on this slide is on security. However, the same mechanism of updates is also used to deliver bug fixes, new features, performance enhancements, and all this is done transparently to the user. The user doesn't need to do absolutely anything. The cluster just updates. Now, along with the Kubernetes binaries, with the Kubernetes cluster, in MicroK8s we package some curated add-ons. These add-ons can be enabled with a single command, MicroK8s enable, and the name of the add-on. And these add-ons range from add-ons for basic operations, like here you see we have add-ons for DNS, MetalLB. We also have for ingress, for local storage. We have other add-ons that have to do with monitoring and logging, like Prometheus or Jaeger. some service meshes like Istio that you see here. And I would also like to point out that we also have an add-on for machine learning, Kubeflow, that pairs very well with the GPU enablement in a single command, MicroK8s enable GPU. Okay, so here we will be discussing how, yes? Okay, sorry, I thought I heard something. So here we will be discussing how high availability is delivered in MicroK8s on with zero ops. The first thing that we need to do, however, is to build some understanding on what Kubernetes is, how it's deployed, and how it works. So in this figure that I guess many of you have already seen, is an overview of Kubernetes deployment. There are two types of nodes, the Kubernetes master, the green one, and the Kubernetes nodes that are the blue ones. The Kubernetes, in the Kubernetes master, you expect to find cluster management services that form the control plane. The Kubernetes node, on the other hand, the blue nodes, are where the user workloads run. So the Kubernetes management services that you see in the in this figure include the API server that serves the API that the administrators talk to. You also see there the scheduler and the control manager that one of the things that they do is that they spawn pods to the Kubernetes nodes, the worker nodes. And then you also see there etcd, which is the data store. The data store essentially keeps the state of the Kubernetes services. It doesn't need to be inside the Kubernetes master, but it is depicted like this in this figure because of its importance to the control plane. The Kubernetes nodes, where the user workloads are hosted, are the blue nodes. You expect to find there kubelet, the container runtime, and also a networking layer that spreads across all the nodes and allows pods to talk to each other. Note here that the users that want to reach their workloads, they talk directly to the Kubernetes nodes, while the administrators talk to the Kubernetes master. So in order to reach high availability in this setup, we have to essentially eliminate single points of failure. We want to quickly detect failures and have failover solutions if something goes wrong, right? So before we go and see what how we have reached to that state, to HA, it is important to understand here that high availability is perceived in different ways by each entity that interacts with Kubernetes. For example, for the end user, HA means that the workload he's running into Kubernetes is always available. For the administrator, things are a bit more complicated. The administrator needs to make sure that the HA expectations of the users are fulfilled. And they also need to be able to always have the API responsive, the API server responsive. That doesn't mean that a specific API server needs to be up all the time. It just means that there has to be an endpoint, one API server through which the admins can talk to the control management service of the Kubernetes cluster. Other things that interest the administrators is that the cluster should have more than one nodes, and that is for spreading the workloads across different nodes, and in case one of them fails, respond the pods to the ones that remain online. And this, as a consequence, means that there has to be a reliable storage so that user data survive these pod migrations. There has to be proper networking so that the users can reach the workloads and the nodes, the Kubernetes nodes. This list that you see there here is not exhaustive. Of course, the administrators need to take care of a lot of other things that are perhaps sometime outside the scope of Kubernetes. Think, for example, reliable network links or external load balancers to the cluster. Now, one level down is the Kubernetes itself. And Kubernetes itself, with the help of the Kubernetes distributions, they need to satisfy the admin needs in terms of HA. So for Kubernetes to be HA, there has to be a data store that is always available. There has to be the Kubernetes cluster should support clustering so that you have, again, more than one nodes. And there has to be a way to configure things like persistent storage and load balancers. Here, in this presentation, we're focusing more on the provisioning of an HA data store. And at the same time, we try to be true to our goal of minimal operational friction. So, the first thing that we have to do is to build a distributed data store. Why is that? Because for the cluster to be highly available, there has to be more than one API servers at a time. So what we do, we take SQLite, this embedded database that is widely used, and we put it into the API server. However, there has to be only one data store on the cluster each time. So we also provide the distributed part of SQLite. And actually, we call this Dqlite. And actually, D in Dqlite means distributed. So Dqlite is an embedded component. It's embedded inside the API server. And each API server plays potentially the role of a node of the distributed data store. I say here potentially because Dqlite transparently selects a subset of nodes to maintain data store copies. We will talk about this at a later slide. So here we focus only on the API server. So having solved the data store issue in this way allows us to freely replicate the API server. And in effect, if we take this to an extreme, we can stop worrying about where the control plane of of your Kubernetes cluster is, because all of the nodes run the API server. And this is kind of a good thing because by replicating the API server, we also improve the reliability of the data store, since the data store is able have more options to migrate its data in case of a failure. Again, all of this is transparent. Dqlite, the layer that we added, takes care of this transparently. The administrator needs only to make sure that there are at least three nodes for an HA cluster to be formed. Now, the next thing that we did is that we, towards our goal of zero ops, is to make every node a Kubernetes node, a worker node, a node that will serve user workloads. This way, we do not need to care about where our workers are, where our masters are. We don't need to keep track on what are the endpoints of the master nodes, because so that the workers can talk to the right masters, because actually the master and the worker nodes, the nodes that serve the workloads, are co-located. So the masters are essentially on the local host where the workers are. Okay. So as you see here, we have less moving parts, and less moving parts results less operational friction. So at this point, I'd like us to see to have a look at what the user experience on the user experience for Kubernetes is. Practically, the only thing that you need to know in order to operate MicroK8s is how to form a cluster. Okay, and this is done through these two commands. On one node, you have to call MicroK8s add node, and then you have to cycle through the nodes that you want to join to the cluster and call MicroK8s join. Let's see a demo of this. I have here two nodes on AWS. Let me make this a bit bigger. Okay. So the first thing that we will do is to install MicroK8s. Sudo snap install MicroK8s --, classic. Okay. So what happens here is that we need to download 200 megabytes of data. Okay. This is the package, the MicroK8s package. As soon as this is downloaded, the services, the Kubernetes services will start. And then MicroK8s will make sure that the CNI, the network layer that is needed, is also deployed. So the installation on this node is done. Let me do the same for the other node. So I was saying about the CNI, the default CNI that we have is Calico. If we here do sudo MicroK8s kubectl get all -a, you will see that we have Calico running. And here we have basically two nodes, completely separate nodes. Kubectl get no. Sorry. We have one node on each machine, and we want these nodes to join these nodes. Okay. So what are we going to do? We're going to call MicroK8s add node on the first of those nodes. You see here that this command prints out the command that you should put on the second node. Okay. And let's see what this command is. It says sudo MicroK8s join. It has a connection string here. The connection string is made of two parts. The first part is the IP and a port on the first node, and the second is a token, a magic token. As soon as the first node sees this magic token, it says, okay, this new node is authorized to join the cluster. The two nodes will exchange all the required information to form a cluster, including certificates, service configurations, user tokens, and all, anything. They will basically form a cluster. And as this happens, let's go to the first node and do and see if we start seeing the node. Okay, that node just registered 4 seconds ago. It's not ready right now, but it will soon get into it will soon get into the ready state. So as I told you, the API server runs on two nodes. So basically, you can go in on the second node now and do and call the same things. Sudo microk8s kubectl get node. Microk8s kubectl get node. And you see exactly the same nodes. Now, there is a command here that gives out the status of the cluster, microk8s status. With this command here, we see that microk8s is indeed running. We are not in an HA in an HA setup. There is only one node that holds the data store. This is the node here. It's actually the first node that we have, this one. We also see the state of each add-on, if they are enabled or not. So in order to reach an HA setup, we have to have at least three of these nodes connected. I will not do that here because I have already a cluster prepared with four nodes. Here, for example, if I do microk8s status, if I do microk8s status here, you will see that there are three nodes that hold the data store. There's also one standby node that we will discuss on a later slide. So this is the formation of the cluster. If we now, at this point, it's a Kubernetes cluster, a four-node Kubernetes cluster. You can enable things like sudo microk8s enable DNS from the curated set of add-ons. This is basically the DNS service that would apply the manifest and also go through all of the nodes and reconfigure them. Now, let me go to another node and actually show you what will happen if we want to remove a node. Okay. So let's do this. Let's see, let's do a microk8s status. So okay, so in the masters include the 43. Okay, so this node is part of the master control plane. Let's get it out of here with microk8s leap. This is how easy it is to exit the cluster. If we run this, you will see. Let's go to. You will see that basically this node will restart, and it will restart as if it is a single node cluster. The rest of the nodes. So the rest of the nodes will pick up this this update, okay? And remember, we had a standby node, so that standby node now became the part of the data store master nodes that keep a copy of the data store. And the cluster remained in an HA setup. It might also be interesting here to do kubectl get all -a -wide to show you that indeed we have pods running on all of the nodes. Okay. Cool. So this is more or less the line that we have that the administrator, the path that we have for the administrator in order to manage the HA. Join the nodes and leave the nodes. Of course, there are variations here depending on what might happen in the cluster, like there's a variation regarding what will happen, how would you remove a node that has crashed? Okay, you have to forcibly remove it. Or how would you add the same, how would you add multiple nodes with the same token? This is also supported. Okay, so let's focus now a bit more on Dqlite. I'm sure that you might be wondering now why we went with Dqlite and not DDCD. So Dqlite is possibly the most widely used embedded database out there. So its value is it's undisputed, right? It is light, reliable, performant, and it is a great fit for zero ops. You can take over all the operations that this database needs, as it is embedded, right? Furthermore, you may have noticed that Dqlite is also used in other Canonical's products, so we are committed to its success, and we feel that we will get multiple gains from using it in MicroK8s as well. Now, at this point, we can dig a bit more into Dqlite. I will give you a very high level view on how Dqlite works. So our contribution to the added part to SQLite is the distributed part, as we said. We have implemented a consensus protocol based on Raft so that all copies of the database, of the data store, stay consistent. In Raft, there has to be a single node that plays the role of the leader. Let's say, to simplify things, this leader keeps the golden copy of the database, of the data store. Of course, if you want to have a leader, you have to have a way to elect the leader, right? So you have to have a node number of nodes that will vote for that leader. This is where the requirement of having at least three nodes to form an HA cluster comes from. If you keep adding nodes, the fourth and fifth node will become standby nodes, as the one that we saw. The standby nodes are there to keep a copy of the database, the data store, but they do not participate in the voting process. They do not vote for the leader. And the role is that if a voter leaves or if the leader leaves, then one of those can be quickly promoted to become a voter. Any other nodes above that, the sixth, seventh, and onwards, these nodes are spare nodes. They do not vote. They do not keep a copy of the database. The only thing that they do is that they proxy any database request that you do to the leader of the cluster. So at this point, we are ready to discuss what happens in more interesting scenarios. Like, for example, here, We have two data centers, DC1 and DC2, with MicroK8s running on them in this deployment. We have on DC1 one voter and two standby nodes. On DC2, we have two voters and one spare node. So what will happen if the two data centers get disconnected? Let's say let's examine first what would happen if the leader was on DC2. The leader here in this figure is marked with an asterisk. So if these two data centers get disconnected, DC1 will basically freeze because it will not be able to reach the leader, and it will not be able to elect a new leader because it has only one voter. It doesn't have the majority of votes. DC2, on the other hand, already has a leader, so it doesn't need to go into an election phase, but doesn't have enough voters, right? So one of the spare nodes will be promoted to standby and then to a voter. So there is practically no disruption in this cluster. A variation of this is what happens if the leader is on DC1, where you have only one voter. In this case, the leader on DC1 will realize that it has lost connection to the majority of the voters. Okay, so it will stop serving any requests. So in this way, you don't risk any data corruption, and you don't risk any inconsistencies, split brain situations, stuff like that. However, it's not going to be able to elect a new leader because there are not enough voters on DC1. So this DC again will freeze. The other DC, DC2, will, since it has two voters, it is able to elect a new leader, and it will do so. And also it will promote again a spare node to become a voter. So this is very briefly how Dqlite works. So what's on our roadmap? What are we working on right now? We want to make MicroK8s. We want to give a good interface, user interface, so that we make MicroK8s failure domain aware, and we also want to provide a way for the administrator to hint which nodes are applicable for hosting Dqlite. Of course, we're also working on CPU and memory improvements. So summing up, MicroK8s is built on solid foundations. We are growing production-grade features. Our vision is that we minimize operational friction. And we are very pleased in the direction we are heading. I would like to take the opportunity here to thank our great community. It's been great that you have you guys, and the amount of work that you are doing is much appreciated. So MicroK8s and Dqlite are on GitHub, open source. You can reach us in microk8s.io. This is our website. And if you want real-time conversations, we are also into the MicroK8s channel on Slack Kubernetes.io. That's it from me. I'm ready to take any questions you may have.
Great. Thanks so much for the presentation. That was great. We have a couple questions coming in here. The first one I'll read off to you. Is it possible to have MicroK8s cluster across a private network, NATS, and public network with MTLS? Assume metal LB and core DNS, et cetera, are enabled.
So, okay. So this is an interesting question. I cannot tell you right now because the main so this question is not a matter of MicroK8s, so it's Kubernetes, okay? The thing that I'm not sure right now, based on this question, is what would happen with the CNI, the network layer that has to be spread across different across the Kubernetes workers, okay, the Kubernetes nodes. This there are certain requirements for this to work. I cannot answer this right now. Like we have to look at how this network is set up exactly.
Okay. The next question is, what components of K8s are not part of MicroK8?
So we don't drop anything from upstream. Perhaps federation is one that you may call out, but it's not part of the core Kubernetes. So in MicroK8s, we don't drop anything. Okay, at the day upstream releases, we also go and build the binaries and release the same day. So it's not that we have the luxury of having a huge patch against the Kubernetes services and drop features and stuff. I can tell you here what services we run. So this is an inspection script that tells you what services are running in MicroK8s. So in a node, we run the proxy, kubelet, scheduler, control manager, the API server. We run containerd and a couple of more services that are used there for setting up MicroK8s itself. So these are the services that we have. I'm not aware of any service of Kubernetes, of upstream Kubernetes that we do not ship.
Okay, those were the questions submitted. Last call for questions. I've got one right away. It says, I am new to MicroK8. Is there an example or use case with IoT and developer workstation? I mean, real-time applications.
So the best place you should start looking for this kind of examples is in tutorials Ubuntu. There is a tutorial that sets up MicroK8s. I don't know though if this is if this matches the part that says IoT and developer workstations. Another source of examples that you can find is our documentation on the microk8s.io/docs. Real-time applications now, that's a very wide best thing is for you to come into the MicroK8s channel and ask us directly. It's a big topic, right?
Okay, great. Looks like there's a comment in here that they're not seeing the presentation. That's totally fine. Constantino, sure. Switch to a different screen. And I think that is it. A reminder that the recording and slides will be posted later today to the CNCF webinars page, cncf.io/webinars. Thanks, Constantinos, again for a great presentation, and thank you all for joining us. Stay safe and hope to see you all at KubeCon Cloud Native Con North America next week. Take care, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.